ओम श्री साई राम। कृष्ण 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 राधे 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 कृष्ण गोविंद गोपाल कृष्ण नारायण साई गोविंद गोपाल कृष्ण नारायण गोविंद गोपाल कृष्ण नारायण गोविंद गोपाल कृष्ण नारायण गोविंद गोपाल कृष्ण नारायण कृष्ण 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 राधे 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 कृष्ण गोविंद गोपाल कृष्ण नारायण ओम श्री साई राम। देर वॉज अ great scientist from US, my very good friend, who served in Swami's university for nearly 10 years as a visiting lecturer, who was part of the team probably, as I know, in the atomic energy in US, and whom Swami saved when he lost his way in his private chopper. He lost connection with the airport and he cried, "Oh God, any God, please help me." And Swami responded on his radio, which was dead. Even according to him, his colleague who was assisting him, he also fell as if dead due to shock. And Swami guided him. And Swami told him, "Do as I say." He had no options but to follow the voice of this strange commander-in-chief, like he says. And he landed safely at Mexico airport. The authorities were baffled. How could you land without any information, permission? Then he showed his identity. And then he was, of course, allowed to take rest. And then, as if by coincidence, there are no coincidences in God's scheme of things, but as if on our human coincidence happenings, he heard the voice of some music going on in a house which happened to be house of Indira Devi, the world famous yoga teacher, a great devotee of Swami. And then he knew the voice that guided him to this place was none other than Swami himself. And he came to Puttaparthi and Swami confirmed it. And then he stayed for many years, nearly 9 to 10 years. Swami even made him the visiting lecturer in his university. He used to teach in Satyasai University. He was very broad-minded person. And those days, I used to attend all the study classes by Kasturi ji, Gopal Rao ji. And he also was permitted to take those study classes, and I was that participant. And he became a very close friend of mine. So once during Christmas, he was given the authority of directing. I think it was one of the first events of Christmas being celebrated at Prashanthi Nilayam. That time there was no Kulwant Hall, of course. So Swami had given them permission to do rehearsals in Purnachandra, and Swami would visit them every day. And he was the director, he made the script, everything. And on the final day, he wanted Swami to come to the Purnachandra hall and see the final rehearsal before it was being enacted next day in Swami's presence in Purnachandra. So he was sitting in portico and with that letter of prayers, and it seems Swami came, "What is going on? God acts as if he knows nothing. That is the difference between human mind and God mind. Or shall we say dog mind and God mind? Our human mind has become dog mind. More kudu. So, anyways, so this devotee, L. Drucker, Swami asked as if he knows nothing. We act as if we know everything and God acts as if he knows nothing. What is going on? Swami, in the rehearsal for tomorrow's function. Oh, tomorrow you are going to have something. Yes, Swami, and drama is being... We are practicing for last so many days. Now, Swami has given permission. Without Swami's permission, nobody can go and do rehearsal in Purnachandra. And Swami had asked him to do, but Swami acts like that. That is his drama. Oh, so you are having drama tomorrow. Who is the director? Now, this man thought that Swami is going to catch him on wrong foot. So, he became alert. And very wisely, according to his own assessment, he said, Swami, of course, you are the director. Then what are you doing? Look at this God. If whatever we say, we should mean it. Swami said, if I am the director, then what are you doing there? Now it was a bigger test. Again, he applied his human mind, the wise mind, the worldly wise mind. He said, Swami, I am your instrument. All are my instruments. Now who can catch this? We all sometimes get this ego when we are blessed with some assignment or some task by Swami. We immediately act as if that we are the chosen ones and we have to do this. And then that ego very certainly, though we may say that we are humble, Swami is doing everything, that lip service, but in our mind we feel and we act as if we are some special entity possessed by Swami, we have become his instruments, channels of his this and that, blah, blah, whatever. Of course, we all are his instruments, we all are his channels. That is why Swami once, 1980s, the boys created a platform, Kingdom of Satyasai. Many of us would not know it, but I was present when it was created. Kingdom of Satyasai. It became very like fire that now Satyasai Kingdom is coming and Swami is blessed. All ex-students, MB boys, Kamal Sahani and all were members of that, Nityanand brother, everybody. I used to see how they participate. They will perform dramas and then after 1 or 2 years, then the Anandpur sisters, they made Kingdom of Mother Sai. And they would also give lectures and perform and give everything. And one day before the Christmas or on the day of Christmas, along with Christmas function, the Kingdom of Mother Sai was celebrated. For a few years, and it became a big news, everybody. Then it seems, I have no confirmation on that, that some students actually started believing that they are the instruments of Swami, chosen ones, this, that, human mind. Then Swami immediately changed the title, Messengers of Satyasai. And he declared in public discourse in Purnachandra, not only my students, everybody, every human born in this creation is messenger of God. Every child born is messenger of God. Why this God had to do this? To make us humble. Not to get carried away that we are some special beings. So I am made to speak, I am made to talk, I am made to do this. I have seen many brothers, students, they are very close to me. They will even disclose their all things, young boys. Because youth, as Swami used to say, monkey by nature is a mad monkey. He will jump from here and there, do stunts. And then if you make him drink and make him intoxicated, then you can imagine a mad monkey intoxicated, gone kiss. And finally, if that mad monkey, intoxicated monkey is hit, bitten by a scorpion, then nobody can control it. Same way, our mind is a mad monkey. When it gets intoxicated with some power, some authority, then the mad monkey becomes terrible monkey. And the same monkey is bitten by the scorpion of personal agenda, personal desires. Then horrible, from terrible to horrible, then nobody can control that mad monkey. So many youth, because youth itself is big arrogance. In young age, every one of us, all of us, without exception, unless you are a Buddha, unless you are Adi Shankara, those souls, they are also there with Swami. I have seen such souls also. A Buddha, a Christ, a Paramahansa may not have more than you. They may not know more than you, but they are more than you. They are elevated souls, enlightened souls. I have seen such students and devotees also. Their presence is enough. But very few. Once one DIG came to Whitefield and he saw the boys and he was so impressed. He told Swami, he thought that he'll make Swami happy by this statement. He said, Swami, your boys are gems. Swami said, no, many are germs. And these boys love Swami so much. Entire evening they will talk only this. Yo, Swami today called us germs. You know, they are so much attached to Swami. Their love is sacred. Nobody can even comment on their relationship. No one dare. It is very sacred. And one to one, heart to heart, love to love. We can't understand. We have no means to understand that. Anyways, so this drucker said, Swami, I am your instrument. Swami said, all are my instruments. Now what to? But this L. Drucker was very mature person. He had seen ups and downs. He has passed through the fire. So he knew. He said, Swami, I am your child. That's good. I will come. This is how this God teaches each and every one with a profound message in such simple and straightforward manner. One should be open enough to receive that message. Once Mr. L. Drucker gave this story during his talks. During summer, he had a thought that those days Puttaparthi was terrible in summers. Nobody would be able to stay. All shops will be closed. Everybody will, hardly few people, permanent residents in ashram. And Swami would also go to Ooty or Kodaikanal or Whitefield. Especially this April and May. That is why the university has 31st March, the last day of university, closing day. All students also go away. So, he thought that in this summer, he would seek Swami's permission because Swami would be going to Ooty or Kodaikanal or maybe somewhere else. He had Swami at some program and he thought he will spend some time in Rishikesh in Swami Shivanand's ashram. Many foreigners are attracted towards Rishikesh and River Ganga, Himalayas, because it is, according to everybody, it is a proven fact that it has some divine vibrations. So he gave letter to Swami that, Swami, I want to visit with your permission. And Swami took the letter. During one of those days before leaving, he had this strange thought. He was just sitting in portico. Swami came along, very few people, those days not many VIPs, there was no hospital, no airport, not many foreigners coming. So Swami used to be very friendly, talking in a very open manner. So he put this question to Swami in portico. He said, "Swami, I have one thing, question to ask, can I?" Swami said, "Yes, please." "Not please." Swami said, "Yes, ask." So he said, "Swami, we all, your devotees, remember you with love in our meditations, in our prayers, in our contemplation, in our study circles, discussions, bhajans. We try our best to remember you with love. Is it that you also remember us anytime? Does God also remember his devotees? Or it is one-way traffic that devotee, because devotees, we remember God because we have some prayers to make or we want enlightenment. We are the seekers. Seeker will remember the giver. But is it that giver, the Lord, also remembers the devotees?" Now it was a very profound question. Seekers would always seek and remember because they have to seek, they have to get something from God. Even moksha, in the liberation, they have to seek from God, seek his grace, seek his love. God doesn't need anybody. It is like somebody saying that fishes need the ocean, ocean does not need the fishes. As simple as that. So does God remember his devotees as we remember him? Or we can also put from my point of view, does God need to remember us? We need to remember him for our upliftment, for our protection, for fulfillment of our prayers, whatever the prayers may be. But how does God need to remember us? And why does God need to remember us? $1 billion question. And this loving God said, "Drakkar, be sure, whenever you remember me with love, wherever you remember me with love, whenever and wherever you remember me with love, be sure that very moment I also remember you with my love." And my love instantly responds to your love. You only remember me with love whenever and wherever you remember. But my remembering also responds. I told many times this, he is not Tathastu God, he is proactive. He says, "My love instantly responds to your love." Not only remembers you with love, but it also responds to your love with my love. That was a great revelation for all of us. Now see the demonstration of this statement. Mr. L. Drakkar, having given letter to Swami, he wrote a letter to Rishikesh Shivananda Ashram, not referring to Satya Sai or anything. He wrote as L. Drakkar with his all American passport, identity and everything, that I am planning to visit and kindly book my room for that. And he sent that letter through one of his friends who had good contacts in Rishikesh. So he was confident that my friend would arrange all the accommodation, all whatever is required. So he went there. It was very hot, of course. He got down from his bus to the ashram. It was 2 o'clock, burning hot. He went to the main gate and knocked the main door. And a security person, yes, sir. He said, I'm so and so, and I have sent some request for accommodation. I'm through this person. So kindly, I have come now. So he looked into all the details in his register or whatever information book. He said, sir, no, there is no such information of your arrival. And nobody has informed us. Sorry. And now it is afternoon, post lunch time. Everybody is taking rest and the gates will not open till 4 o'clock. He said, can you at least allow me to come in and sit? And then when evening 4 o'clock, I will talk to the administration. Sorry, sir. First of all, the entire ashram is full. And we have instructions not to allow anyone. Only inmates, if they are out, they can come in. But we have no information about your arrival. And he closed the door. Hot sun, no accommodation. He was so thirsty, so hungry. He found one tree somewhere and sat down there. And then he said, no, what foolishness I committed. I should have stayed back in Puttaparthi. At least Swami has given me a room. Even if Swami was not there, even if it was hot, at least I would have been in my room with fan, with food, with water. And here I am like a fool. And as soon as he remembered Puttaparthi in his mind, suddenly a thought came to him of this revelation of God. He said, in all this tensions and stress and everything, I forgot to remember Swami. Because all the time coming by bus, I was concentrating only on getting accommodation, whether my friend has informed or not, what will happen. And then when he refused, my mind was totally out of touch with my Lord. And Swami has given such assurance. So he said, immediately I sat down there under the tree in that meditative mood, closed my eyes, and for just not even a minute, I uttered, Swami, I love you. I didn't ask for anything. Nothing. This very thought, this very prayer made it so cool for me. Swami, I love you. Swami, I love you. Swami, I love you. I felt the cool breeze in that hot sun going across my face. I was feeling so happy. I went on chanting, Swami, I love you. Swami, the more I chant, the more coolness around me. It was not even 60 seconds that I did this. The door opens. A person comes to me. Excuse me, sir, are you Mr. Drucker from Puttaparthi? He said, yes. Oh, sorry, sir, there is a telegram. After you came, I went and inquired. There is a telegram from Puttaparthi that you are coming. Please come in. You can imagine the tears of joy in his eyes. How can we not love this God? I don't know. Not only that, when he goes inside, he is made comfortable. The main accommodation officer comes. He tells him, sir, though the ashram is full, as the watchman informed you, he told you the facts. But today morning, one gentleman from US has left. For nearly 1 month, he is gone. He is in India, but he has gone on some trip. And he has left his room. It is well furnished, air conditioned. Everything is there. The keys are with us. Because in like in every ashram, when you leave, you have to keep the keys with the ashram authorities. So you can occupy at least for 1 month. He said, sir, I come only for 10 days. No, no, you can stay for 1 month, no issue. And we are sorry we didn't get that information in time and you made you wait outside. Please come. And they took him to his air conditioned room, well furnished. He said it was like a star hotel. He enjoyed that trip. But when he came to Puttaparthi, this thought came to him that who sent the telegram? I didn't inform anybody because I gave just a letter to Swami and I am going to Rishikesh. And I don't expect Swami to instruct somebody to send telegram. Of course, Swami Shivananda was a great, great, great devotee of Swami. Swami had stayed in his ashram in the 60s. But Swami would not send telegram for one individual. So he went and inquired from the telegraph office. Those days, telegraph office was just in the East Prashanti ground floor, one room, manual, everything. So he went to the postmaster and everybody knew him because he was a star. Because when a telegram is sent, they used to keep record of it and one duplicate copy of it. It was all manual work. They said, sir, we have not sent any telegram to Rishikesh Ashram. Nowhere, no ways. There is no record and we have not sent it. Sure. This is how divinity works. Boundless ocean of compassion. How can we give him options? How can we not compel him with our love? How can we allow him to leave us? How can we not love him intensely enough, selflessly enough, fearlessly enough to manifest himself as he has promised? I am ready to come, I am ready to give again and again and again, not once, again and again. And he is immortal God. He can't be in samadhi and multi-organ failures. He is supreme, eternal. He can manifest himself whenever and wherever he decides. If we need him, we deserve him. And if we love him truly, we need not even need him. Jai Sai Ram.